Going on? Can everyone hear me okay? Is this all right? Well, let me say first that I'm honored to speak here in this wonderful institution that not only commemorates the seminal disaster of the modern world, this institution, I think, speaks volumes about Kansas City and its commitment to civic education. This memorial began as a place to commemorate the city's dead. It transformed over time, especially recently, into much more than that. It now educates this entire nation about the First World War and how it transformed the world. So again, I'm honored to be here. I wish to thank, first of all, the National World War I Museum at Liberty Memorial for hosting this event, for providing the space and allowing me to talk to you today. And also, I'd like to thank the loyal sons and daughters of Notre Dame, and especially for Mark Dold, for the invitation to come to Kansas City. One of the great blessings of teaching at Notre Dame is its fiercely loyal and highly engaged alumni. Now, faculty often complain about its fiercely loyal and highly engaged alumni, but I see it as a blessing. They, of course, began their commitment to Notre Dame as highly motivated, hardworking, and eminently teachable Notre Dame undergraduates. So how many of you guys here are Notre Dame alumni? So a good number of you. And how many of you are parents of Notre Dame alumni? Yeah, so the Fighting Irish takes in a lot of people, doesn't it? I mean, we all become Fighting Irish over time. I mean, I came from the University of North Carolina, and I've been readily accepted at this august institution. First of all, I'd like to apologize for my name. I know maybe you guys are like, how did Deak come out of this? It's a Hungarian name, and it should have an accent on the A. But of course, like all East European immigrant families, my family came through Ellis Island about 100 years ago. And I suspect that a wily Irishman who was also coming through Ellis Island stole our accent, because it disappeared. But yes, indeed, my name is John Deak, and I'll be happy to take questions after my talk's over. We'll stick around. There are microphones that will be passed around to you if you want to see if I know really what I'm talking about. I'm going to give you a first image. For those of you who have been to Notre Dame, you probably recognize this. This is over the east entranceway to the Basilica of the Sacred Heart. Now, I'm sure it's familiar to many of you, God, Country, Notre Dame. It's on many football shirts, you know, T-shirts that people wear into football games. And for me, not being a domer, and seeing the T-shirts, I thought this had something to do with just patriotism. I had no idea what this was about. And of course, on posters and various things at Notre Dame, the posters always focus on the seal and this relief right here. This is the picture we usually see. Now, the T-shirt that's worn with God, Country, Notre Dame on it has become a motto of many of our students, especially those who study political science, government, things like that. And it's on T-shirts for sale in Notre Dame bookstore, on posters. It's itself really, for those of us who are young enough to know what this means, it's become its own meme. In fact, God, Texas, Notre Dame is the motto for the Texas Student Association. I'm wondering when they're finally just going to secede, but, you know, I'm waiting. But here's the thing. Why is this thing there? I passed through this. I mean, the parking lot, the easy access for me to the parking lot and to go to Mass is always through this gateway, and I've seen this a million times. It's not original to the building. So panning back, we see that above the doorway, again in relief, is our gallant dead in glory everlasting. And on either side of the doorway into the basilica are these two bronze plaques with lists of names. This is a World War I memorial. And like here in the memorial hall of this building, or this structure, we remember our gallant dead, the names of Notre Dame students, staff, who died in the First World War. Now, I've been at Notre Dame for almost 5 years. And last weekend, past the Basilica, and I left through the eastern exit door, and for the first time in 5 years, I looked up. And I was surprised. I had no idea about this. We go into the vestibule here. This is the between the doorways into the Basilica, and we at the top would be the doorway leading into the actual church. It becomes apparent this whole thing, the whole entryway, is a World War I memorial. And it was built in 1924. This is a silent memorial. It really, most people don't know about it. Most people don't think about it. Of course, this is a doughboy's helmet with a light in it. And here we have the various insignia of regiments and divisions of which Notre Dame people served in. You can see the Rainbow Division right there, like your Rainbow Boulevard. What's striking to me is how silent this memorial is, how students don't know about it, faculty don't know about it. And I actually had to write the rector of the Basilica to ask, when was this built? Because it's not even in the brochures on the Basilica of the Sacred Heart. The Basilica and the silence is the starting point for my talk today, which is really about the general problem that history has, remembering and also forgetting. When we commemorate things, we also at the same time, we are remembering something, but we're also forgetting something. We commemorate some things, and by lifting them up and making them stand out, we are forgetting other things. We're not talking about other things. And by not commemorating some things, by making thing A more memorable than thing B, we will forget. We'll forget over time. We recite narratives of facts from the past and letting others fall in oblivion. Now, for you high schoolers that are here for extra credit, I know that's pretty deep. We'll get there. I will make it make sense, I promise. And if I don't make it make sense, you can ask me, why didn't it make sense? Some of you who have multiple children, you know this, right? You have children sitting around the dinner table, and you always know the squeaky wheel gets the grease, and the silent one sort of falls back into the back of your mind. I was the youngest, so that's where that comes from. That's getting over that psychology. And we have this problem as historians, right? Academics like me have become more esoteric over the last 30 years. And so we say things, and we talk about things that hardly seem relevant. But one of the good ideas that maybe come out of the past 30 years in historical practice is that historians, their job today, given that we've written a bunch of books and we have, you know, we pretty much know everything, so we think. The job of historians today is to find the silences. What aren't we talking about? What has gotten lost? What stories have been forgotten? What perspectives have been marginalized? Why has this history of the Basilica entryway been largely forgotten? Why do I think about it in terms of the football team and not in terms of the First World War? Why am I not talking about the blue-gold game yesterday? Why am I talking about this? So there are two processes of forgetting that I want to just mention to you. I think we forget, first of all, when we think something isn't important, and we decide to push it aside. And we forget, second of all, when there are dominant stories that we tell over and over at the expense of other stories that could and should be told. So if I start this lecture by giving you this sort of deep statement that history is just as much about forgetting as remembering, this is the way historians work. We need to tell stories, so we select the facts that are most relevant, And in the process, we tell some things and not others. And that leads me to the topic that I study, the topic that I do, the topic that I teach at Notre Dame, which is the history of the Habsburg Empire. How many of you have ever taken a class on the history of the Habsburg Empire? One, two, three, four? Well, this is wonderful. I am teaching the history of the Habsburg Empire for the first time at Notre Dame. They finally let me do it because they were afraid that enrollment wouldn't be enough to actually cover this class. So I've taught German history, I've taught the history of revolutions of 1848. They've even let me teach philosophy of history. They didn't want me to teach this stuff because no one would take it. So after whining for 4 years, and I'm really good at it, I am the youngest child of three, they finally let me do it. And so I'm teaching this class for the first time. Now, as an undergraduate at the University of North Carolina, I never had a class on the Habsburg Empire. And as a graduate student at the University of Chicago, I never had a class in the Habsburg Empire. So standing behind a podium twice a week, every week this semester, has been the first time I've ever been in a class on the Habsburg Empire. Unfortunately, it's mine. So if any of you guys have any hints for me who've ever taken a class in the Habsburg Empire, please let me know afterwards. I'll be very willing to hear what you have to say. For me, the First World War and the Habsburg Empire is really, well, a good analogy would be Star Trek. How many of you guys have ever seen or remember the old Star Trek with William Shatner? All right, so, awesome. Now you know this, we all know this. If by chance, in the first 5 minutes, you meet a lieutenant, an ensign wearing a red shirt, you know he's going to die. So you can forget whatever special interest story they're giving you about this guy in the red shirt. For me and the histories of the First World War, the Habsburg Empire is the red-shirted ensign. Historians who write about the First World War will mention it, they'll talk about nationality problems, they'll talk about all the languages, they'll say that the emperor was really old. And by chapter two, we can forget about it because it's destined for failure and it's destined for collapse. And this is one of the reasons why we have forgotten this place. Another reason is the way that we think about European history. So Western civilization, wonderful course. European history, you guys, you're gonna take AP European history? Sometime soon, or are you taking it now? Senior year. What year are you guys in now? So you got some time. Well, I'm gonna give you a hint. I'm gonna tell you, you better take notes, exactly what history of Western civilization is about. When we teach Western civilization at universities, We usually split it into two semesters. Everything from Plato to the Renaissance, and then from the Renaissance to NATO. Western Civ is Plato to NATO. That's the way we know it. That's the way I was taught to teach it. That's our little device. And Western Civ follows a particular arc. It's about, first of all, Christianity. So the rise of Christianity, the rise of the church. And then in the middle part, we have the rise of princes and princely power that eventually turns into the rise of states, nation states, and the decline of the church. That is the arc of Western civilization. So here's the problem with that. It doesn't leave much room for this thing. A very Catholic multinational empire that can never be a nation state doesn't really fit in to our scope of what Western civilization is. Doesn't fit in at all. So it's best just to ignore it, leave it out. That's what our textbook writers do, and that's what we do when we teach Western Civ. And this is what I've been having to deal with most of my life. But I think we forget, at the expense of our own understanding of the complexity and the very richness of Europe and its past, that understanding this monarchy, how this monarchy went to war, how war changed this monarchy, and how then it fell apart, can tell us much about Europe, its history, and the ideas, the very ideas that created the 20th century, with all of its violence, genocide, and then purposeful forgetting. Now, if I'm technologically challenged, but I took a map of Europe, and I took a stencil thing on the computer, and I basically drew the outline of what the Habsburg monarchy would be today. These are the countries that were in it. These are the nations that were in it. My family immigrated from here. Way back when. In the history of Western civilization, if Austria-Hungary doesn't fit very well, what we're taught is that it can seem rather strange. And if we learn anything about it, we learn that there are 13 different language groups, and as historians, to make life simple, we always align language group or language spoken to nationality. We automatically assume that if you spoke Croatian, you woke up every day and said, I'm a Croatian. And we had one monarch in 1914, Franz Josef, who came to the throne as an 18-year-old man in 1848. By 1914, he was pretty old. He was 83. He had served on the Austrian throne for 66 years. And more, even more strange to the modern eye, he was emperor and king. He was emperor, and those various colorful parts, that was his title, and the less colorful part in the Kingdom of Hungary, he was king. That's why it was called Austria-Hungary. It had two governments, two parliaments, two prime ministers, but one army and one foreign policy. Now, of course, he wasn't the one who was killed, right? The other Austrian that we know, we probably don't know the ruler, right? When we learn the history of the First World War, the actual emperor, we kind of forget about him. We rather talk about Franz Ferdinand. Franz Ferdinand would eventually be assassinated in Sarajevo. Now is this still on? Yeah, put that over here. Now, Franz Josef, of course, is an old man. That guy, definitely an old man. This guy, not so much. Franz Josef, that guy, had been guiding the monarchy for 66 years. And everyone knew that this man was going to die. And people were waiting. There were governments in waiting. There were people drawing up reform plans for the monarchy. Because they knew when this guy died, everything would change. And that when this guy, Franz Ferdinand, the heir to the throne, became emperor, things would change deeply. Franz Josef, as an 81-year-old man, caught the flu in 1911. And everyone thought this was going to be the time. And it got better. Just like in a Monty Python movie, he got better. In fact, he did more than linger on. And so Franz Ferdinand had been the center of a lot of attention, even in the monarchy. He was born in 1863, and he wasn't raised to be the next emperor because he wasn't Franz Josef's son. He was Franz Josef's nephew. Franz Josef had a son, and his son committed suicide in 1889. And still, Franz Ferdinand wasn't given a monarch's education. He was trained to be a military man. He was going to serve as a general in the Habsburg military, but not be an emperor. So Franz Ferdinand didn't learn the 13 languages of the realm like Franz Josef did and Franz Josef's son did. Franz Ferdinand couldn't speak Hungarian, which neither can I. It's an impossible language. That's the first thing my family forgot when they came to America. That's probably why they immigrated. And so Franz Ferdinand as the heir to the throne was also probably impatient, we could say. And this is what we learn about him. He suffered from tuberculosis, and so he wasn't declared the heir presumptive until close to 1900. But he knew it was his, so he was getting impatient, and he didn't really like the family rules so much. And then he got married. So how many of you have married for love? Everyone who came here with a partner has raised their hand. This is just testing, make sure you're awake. Franz Ferdinand married for love. He married a mere countess, which was a problem. It was a problem for the Habsburg family. This is one of Europe's oldest noble families, sitting on one of the most noble European thrones, a long document of family law that stipulated that heirs to the throne had to, or all members of the Habsburg family, had to get the old emperor's, the head of the house, his approval to marry. And they had to marry people of equal standing to themselves. And there was a list of the noble families of Europe who were of equal standing in the Habsburgs. And Franz Ferdinand fell in love with a mere countess who was a lady-in-waiting to one of his cousins. And her family, the countess's family, was not on this list. The old emperor learned that it was his duty as a Habsburg, to find someone else to marry. He could not marry this woman. And Franz Ferdinand said, "It's her or no one else." And so Franz Josef made this political decision that better to have a monarch with a happy family life than a bachelor. That wouldn't look good if he was a bachelor. So he gave Franz Ferdinand permission to marry. But what happened? Franz Josef made Franz Ferdinand promise to do a few things. And in fact, Franz Ferdinand had to sign a document. The first thing Franz Ferdinand couldn't do, none of his heirs, should he have any, were allowed to inherit the throne. They could inherit his personal property. They couldn't inherit the throne. And secondly, the marriage would be labeled morganatic. Now, those of us in America, we don't know what that means. We have basically, legally, a classless society. But a morganatic marriage is a marriage between two unequals. And when you're the head of the House of Habsburg, when you're the future emperor, this means that anything you do as the head of state or as the heir presumptive, in Franz Ferdinand's case, you have to do alone. State dinners where Franz Ferdinand was present, there always had to be an empty place sitting next to him for his wife, who could not sit at the table. If Franz Ferdinand chose to ride in any official capacity as a member of the August House of Habsburg, he had to ride alone. His wife could not sit in a carriage with the Habsburg seal on it. And the family, the rest of the Habsburgs, made sure that Franz Ferdinand had to abide by these rules. They shunned his wife, and they shunned his children. And I say this as a means of explaining something that we always read in the history books about Franz Ferdinand, that he was grumpy. He was grumpy, but he was an outcast to his own family, and no one would ever listen to him. I hope what you're hearing is that I'm sort of problematizing the basic narrative of the Habsburg Empire in the First World War. The grumpy guy was a happy family man. All right. The other thing I'm going to tell you is that Austria-Hungary wasn't Germany. It didn't have the continent's largest army. It didn't have the major industrial production Germany had. But it wasn't a backward state that was falling apart. Not at all. In fact, it was a state that, one, politically worked, and two, had a foreign policy that was quite adventurous. And the locus of most of its foreign policy was in the Balkans. Its objectives in the Balkans for, I would say, 40 years were to maintain peace, to build infrastructure, so that transportation and trade can flourish. It wanted to become richer. It wanted open markets. It wanted free trade as much as possible. And it wanted to prop up this thing, the Ottoman Empire, that was slowly losing ground in the Balkans. Now, the Ottoman Empire had conquered this area of the world really between the 13th and the 16th century. And its control was receding. And the Habsburgs wanted to prop up the Ottoman Empire, or at least, if it couldn't, when Serbia declares independence in 1867 and Romania in around the same time, 1866, 67, they want favorable trade with these new countries too. They want to maintain peace because it's in peacetime that you can make money, unless you're building rifles. But that's another story. They weren't building rifles. The other object of foreign policy was to limit the expansion of this thing up here, which is the world's largest country, but it only is up there in pink. And for those of you who read the newspaper, there's the Crimea. All of this became more complicated in the 1870s. Bosnian Serbs revolt against the Ottoman Empire. Serbia joins in, declares war, and so does Russia. Austria, in trying to maintain a balance of power in the Balkans to keep Russia from expanding its influence, tries to stop Russia from actually marching all the way down to Constantinople, to Istanbul. And as a result, the great powers of Europe intervene. And the Treaty of Berlin is signed. And part of the Treaty of Berlin is that Austria, in order to keep the peace in the region, will occupy Bosnia-Herzegovina. Not annex it, it still belongs to the Ottoman Empire, but they're going to occupy it. Now for Serbs, of course, this is a problem. Bosnia, I have some facts and figures, had about 1.8 million people. And it wasn't considered a province of the Habsburg Empire. It was an occupied territory. And the Habsburgs, really what they did in Bosnia was over time develop it like a colony. The governor was a general in the military, and the government of Bosnia was under the finance ministry of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. It was basically a colony. But it was a special type of colony. It wasn't just to extract resources. They tried to win the people over. They built roads, they built schools, they built rail networks. They tried to bring prosperity to the place. Now Bosnia, of course, we know this from recent history, is a mixture of religions. And these religions tend to have been folded out into ethnic categories. The Catholics in Bosnia are considered Croatians. The Muslims in Bosnia are Bosniaks. And back in the day, they called them just Turks. And the Orthodox Christians were considered Serbs. They all spoke the same language. And despite Serbian designs in the Balkans, Serbia, after the annexation of Austria, really turned to a pro-Austrian policy. They developed peace treaties with Austria, financial treaties, trade treaties, all these kinds of things. All this changed abruptly in 1903, which is now beginning to be a story we know. So what would you guys say if the CIA developed a special wing of black ops operatives that could do anything they wanted, and the president had knew they were there, but had no control over them. Would you think this was a problem? That's what Serbia had in the Black Hand, or what it was called in Serbian, which I could try to pronounce if you want, but I'm mic'd up, and that would be embarrassing. It means unity or death. This was a Serbian nationalist group led by Colonel Dragutin Dimitrijević, who was a colonel, and it was like a secret society. It was like a university fraternity with guns. They would put masks on people, lead them into basements, light candles, probably make them eat dog food and do wall stands for a week, everything that fraternities do. But their goal was to increase Serbia's size and bring other ethnic Serbs into Greater Serbia. And the president, or the king of Serbia and the prime minister, knew they existed and could do nothing about it, especially after 1903. Because in 1903, members of the Black Hand broke into the Serbian royal palace and murdered the king and queen, brutally. Shot them full of holes, emptied clips into them, and then mutilated their bodies and installed their own king, a member of a rival Serbian family, on the throne. Who embarked on an anti-Austrian foreign policy. All those trade agreements, they were gone. At the same time in Austria, weird political intrigue was happening at the top of the army. The guy on the right is Oskar Potiorek. He was second in command of the Austrian army. And when the first in command, the head of the general staff, retired, he thought it was his, the position of head of the Austrian army. He was passed over for promotion. And instead, a young buck and great sort of military strategist, Konrad von Hötzendorf, Franz Konrad von Hötzendorf, becomes chief of the general staff. Potiorek becomes the governor of Bosnia. The people at the time summed up Konrad's idea about world politics in three words. I'll give them in German, and then I'll translate them into English. Krieg, Krieg, und Krieg. War, war, and war. Anything that happened, Italy sneezes, let's go to war. Italy attacks the Ottoman Empire, let's go to war. Serbia attacks the Ottoman Empire, let's go to war. Konrad was a strange man, and all those sort of rumors about his love affair with Gina von Reiningenhaus, which I can talk about in maybe a Q&A, are probably true. So, adding to the fire, we have the two Balkan Wars of 1912-1913. Serbia ends up aggrandizing itself over these two wars. This is Serbia in 1878. By 1914, it had doubled its territory and added an extra third to its population. The Ottoman Empire was crumbling. Austrian envoys in the Balkans, because they were military observers, sent back reports to Vienna of numerous atrocities in the Balkan Wars. Burning of villages were common. Ethnic cleansing of Muslims, Bulgarians. Officers would shoot all the men in a village and leave it to the common soldiers to execute all the men or all the women and children. And in Vienna, General Konrad pressed for war. Tellingly, who was the person that resisted Konrad's treaties for war the most? It was Franz Ferdinand. Now, in the history, when we learn about World War I history, I've often read that Franz Ferdinand was a warmonger, but he was the single most advocate for peace within the leadership of Austria-Hungary, because he thought as soon as Austria-Hungary gets in a war in the Balkans, Russia will come over the border. And he thought this would be a terrible mistake. So, in June 1914, Franz Ferdinand, who is the chief military inspector of the army, this is his title as an Habsburg Archduke, decides to inspect military maneuvers in Bosnia that were being held in June in Bosnia. This was Franz Ferdinand's way of visiting Oskar Potiorek, the second in command who had gotten passed over, and maybe shutting Konrad up. And so I've found some pictures from the Austrian National Library, some photos for you, of the day that Franz Ferdinand was on maneuvers, and then when he would, the day that he visited Sarajevo. Also, the maneuvers in Bosnia were a way of showing Habsburg strength. We are going to stay involved, and we are going to try to limit Serbian aggression in the Balkans. But this is not tantamount to war. So on Sunday, June 28th, St. Vitus's Day, after observing the maneuvers in Bosnia, Franz Ferdinand traveled with his wife because he was acting as chief military inspector and he could bring his wife along. He travels to Sarajevo on a semi-official visit. As the motorcade approached the city, seven terrorists, 18 to 20 year old, were positioned along the apple quay and armed with bombs and pistols. They also carried cyanide pills. They were stationed along this broad boulevard that fronts the river Mjatska in Sarajevo. As the motorcade passed, I think it was going this way, the first assassin, armed with a bomb with a percussion cap, had like a 12-second fuse on it. So you have to break the percussion cap, it'll make a loud noise, and count. 12 is a long time. I know, you've been sitting there for like 30 minutes. 12 is a long time. And then throw the bomb. He doesn't break the percussion cap. The first one loses his nerve and doesn't do it. He can't do it. The second assassin smashes the percussion cap on the bomb, waits, throws the bomb as the motorcade goes by, probably 30, 35 miles an hour. And the bomb reaches Franz Ferdinand's car, which is a cabriolet, bounces off the canopy that's pulled back, and rolls into the street. Now, Franz Ferdinand's traveling in a motorcade. And in the car behind are all these high-ranking military officers. And just as that car reaches the bomb explodes underneath. No one dies, but some are seriously wounded. So the assassin then bites into a cyanide pill and throws himself over the embankment into the river. So have any of you guys been to Sarajevo? Yeah, you? Anybody else? So when were you there? So what month?
Springtime.
How high was the river? Yeah. In the spring, it wasn't very high. In June, it's barely a trickle, right? He didn't drown. Some citizens went in there and fished him out. And the cyanide pill he bit into didn't work. It burned his mouth. It was pretty weak. So he was captured. Franz Ferdinand decided that this was just the action of a rogue maniac. And he goes on with his program. They're going to go to City Hall where he's going to deliver a speech. And then, changing the itinerary, he decides to go to the hospital and visit the military men who have been injured in the bomb blast. So after leaving the city hall, they go back along the apple quay. And this is where the bomb exploded the first time. Now, on the return trip, the original itinerary said they were going to go down Franz Josef Street, which is a tight, small street in comparison to the street along the river. But of course, to go to the hospital, they best go along the apple quay where they can drive a lot faster. No one told the drivers. The first two cars of the motorcade turned onto Franz Josef Street, and the third car contained Franz Ferdinand the Archduke and Potiorek, the military general and governor of Bosnia. Right as they reach the corner, Potiorek yells for the car to stop. And cars, I don't know if a 1912 Grey von Stift convertible had a reverse gear. I've been trying to find this out. So if any of you guys know about old automobiles, let me know. But in any case, the car came to a halt. I'll talk to you afterwards. The car comes to a halt right there at the corner, where another assassin, Gavrilo Princip, happened to be standing. He'd given up. He thought they weren't coming back. He was the fourth assassin. The car stops to a halt right here in front of him. He was standing among the crowd. He had no place to really to break the percussion cap on the bomb. So he pulled out his revolver and fired two shots. The first shot hit Archduchess or Duchess Sophie in the stomach, and it severed her gastric artery. And she was dead within seconds. The second shot hit Franz Ferdinand in the jugular, and he survived for a few seconds longer. By 11:30 that morning, they were both dead. It's quite ironic when you read sort of the report about Princip's training in Serbia, because apparently he was the best shot among a bunch of bad shots. If you go to Vienna now, hopefully you'll go after June 28th when the World War I exhibition reopens at the Vienna Military History Museum. But you can see the car that Franz Ferdinand was riding in, and you can see his tunic, his coat, complete with the blood stains and the incision marks where they tried to cut open the uniform to see how bad the injury was. He was hit up here. Investigation begins in Sarajevo immediately. And here they were able to round up a bunch of conspirators really quickly because one of them blabbed. It wasn't Princip, it was one of the others. The other, Ilic, it was his name, he recruited everyone else. They all went to high school together, basically. They were between 18 and 20 years old. And because Ilic blabbed, the Austrian police were able to dig up the pistols, and they were able to dig up the bombs that these folks hid. And they were all made where? Serbia. So it became pretty clear by July 1st what was going on. But what are they going to do? Franz Ferdinand's body is being transported back to Vienna. They have an inkling that Serbia is involved, and the police were making inroads into a deep plot. And by 2 weeks later, they knew that Dmitrijevic, the head of the Black Hand, that his second in command was definitely involved. But remember what I told you about Franz Ferdinand being an advocate for peace? Sometimes we learn that the Serbs killed Franz Ferdinand because he was anti-Serb. But really they killed him because he was the biggest dove in an assembly of basically advisors to the emperor. And so early on in Austria, all the advisors to the emperor on foreign policy got together to discuss what was going to be done. And the one person who would probably have held them out of any war was dead. Austria-Hungary had two prime ministers. The prime minister of Austria was a Count Störk. The prime minister of Hungary was Stephen Tisza, who was the lone Protestant in this group, and he was the lone holdout. He wanted peace at any price. He did not want a war against Serbia, and he especially didn't want more Slavs in the empire. The foreign minister of Austria is this guy here, Franz Berchtold. And Berchtold decided pretty early on that a war against Serbia would be beneficial. If they're going to murder the heir to the throne, what else are they capable of? But he knew that Russia had promised to protect Serbia. And so he quickly sent one of his underlings, a Count Hoyos, Alexander Hoyos, to Berlin to feel the Germans out. He wired to the ambassador there in Berlin, Laszlo Sergeny, that they planned on making demands on the government of Belgrade, and if they refused, they would invade. They wanted to eliminate, I quote, Serbia as a political power in the Balkans. Hoyos met with the Emperor of Germany, Wilhelm II, and Wilhelm's advisors on July 5th. And Wilhelm at first thought any war, any quick war, would probably be a disaster. Wilhelm's military advisors said, there is no way that Russia is going to come into this war. We can do this. Back Austria. And they rev Wilhelm up. I don't know if you've ever read books about Kaiser Wilhelm of Germany, but he was one of these impetuous folks that you could get started. I don't know if you have a crazy uncle that always comes over for Thanksgiving. But you know how to push your crazy uncle's buttons, right? Talk about politics, you just mention Notre Dame football and the guy will go crazy and he'll just start ranting. Wilhelm II was sort of like this, and his advisors sort of knew what to do with him. So they did. They revved him up. And he ends up promising Austria full support in a war against Serbia. We have your back. So here is Ambassador Sergeny, who was really old, he was about 76, and really wanted to retire. Count Hoyos, looking rather grim. And Wilhelm II. Hoyos sends two telegrams back to Vienna saying Germany promises their full support. But here's the thing. Conrad woke up on July 6th, chief of the Austrian military command. And he has what I like to call an oh crap moment. Because for the last several years, in July, he's let the entire army go on harvest leave. Harvest leave is when people leave their bases, leave their regiments, and go work in the fields for a month to bring in the harvest. And he had signed that order, a few weeks ago. And so everyone had left. So Mr. War had to stand there in front of the Austrian War Council and say, can we delay it by about 3 weeks? Whoops. Well, the cabinet meets again on July 7th. By this time, Franz Josef had been convinced because Störg, the war minister, Krobaten, Konrad, the finance minister who was in charge of Bosnia, who wanted revenge, and the foreign minister, Berchtold, that they should attack Serbia. Everyone except Tisza. They were promised and they were assured by Germany that Russia would stay out of the war. And if Russia did intervene, the Germans would help them take care of it. They'd be able to hold out. Tisza doesn't believe any of it. Tisza said, we need to hold on. We need to make any war against Serbia look like we have left no other stone unturned. We need to give them an ultimatum. It needs, and they need to either accept it or we'll go to war. But war needs to be the last resort. So Tisza, during this meeting of the 7th, makes two points. Austria is going to make no surprise attack. They're going to wait. Well, Conrad has provided that opportunity already by giving everyone harvest leave. And Austria would not annex any Serbian territory because in his mind, they didn't need any more ethnic groups in the monarchy, or at least any more Serbs. Of course, back in the deep recesses of their mind, they also must be worried about the Triple Entente in France and Russia, especially. Because since 1892, France and Russia had been in alliance. And of course, this was a newspaper cartoon. It's pretty racy. Sorry about that. Marianne, the symbol of France, in a tent with the Russian bear. She's wearing no clothes. Sorry about that. But this is an anti-German alliance, the Franco-Russian alliance. I'll just move on. Austrian diplomacy also knew one other thing, a complicating factor. The president of France and his prime minister were going on a state visit to Russia. And they were going to be there for 4 days, July 20th to the 23rd. Now, the Austrian War Cabinet did not, under any circumstances, want France and Russia to be discussing a possible war. These were allies. And so they knew that any ultimatum they sent to Serbia had to go to Serbia after this date, July 23rd, or at least after the ship left port. So these are our Russian folks. Sazonov, the foreign minister, Tsar Nicholas II, and then the president, Poincaré, and his prime minister, Vivani, who I think spent the entire trip throwing up because he was seasick. Thank God for planes. I get seasick too. Of course, the German staff at this point that had backed Austria, they knew that their emperor was a bit of a nutter. And so they put him on a yacht and put him on the Baltic Sea, incommunicado, so he couldn't change his mind. And at the same time, the German military leadership, Moltke, the chief of staff of the German army, is vacationing in Austria. And the admiral was vacationing in Switzerland. Everybody was out to lunch. Finally, the Ministerial Council of Austria-Hungary July 19th, decides for war. But first, of course, they have to give Tisza his due. And they approve the final text of the ultimatum, which in Austrian language, they do speak German there, but it's a different type of German. They don't call this an ultimatum at all. They call it a diplomatic note with a time limit. And they decide that the text of the diplomatic note would be delivered to the Prime Minister of Serbia at the very moment that the French ship left the Russian port, carrying the President and Prime Minister, and as soon as it got out of wireless range. Smart, huh? So the ambassador to Serbia, and I always have one typo, and there it is. Baron Gisel von Gieslingen goes to the prime minister's office to deliver the ultimatum. But guess what happens? If you're the Prime Minister of Serbia and you heard word that there is an ultimatum being delivered, would you sit around and wait for it? He left town. And Gisel von Giesselin walks in there, and it's just one of his staff members. He'd written in French. And he can't speak German. In fact, he's pretty useless. And that was his greatest use to Pasic, the Prime Minister of Serbia. Giesselin explains to the staff member what this is. This is an important note for the Prime Minister. It has a time limit. And the staff member refuses to accept it. It's like getting delivered divorce papers, right? He won't touch it. And so Gisel von Giesselin just leaves it on the desk and leaves. A diplomatic note with a time limit. It had 10 points, basically. Importantly was this one. Austria-Hungary will direct an investigation of Serbia into subversive movements. Austria-Hungary will send its police to conduct its own investigation because they don't trust the Serbs. Everything else seems doable. Serbia's immediate response is to prepare for war, because they knew it was coming. And just if you're paying attention, the President of France is still in the Baltic. Britain's Prime Minister Edward Grey is determined to stay out of a Balkan war. And Russia's Foreign Minister Sazonov is determined to intervene. Serbia rejected points 2, 5, and 6, just in time for the deadline. Gisel takes the 6:30 train back to Austria-Hungary. And as soon as he gets back in Austria-Hungary, he telegrams and says, the ultimatum has been rejected, we're going to war. Mobilization by Austria began at midnight on the 28th of July. Now this is when, for the most of Europe, the July crisis really starts with the ultimatum. Germany is trying to make sure that Russia and France stay out of the war. Britain doesn't know what it's doing, and Austria and Serbia know they're going to war. And I'm not prepared to really talk about that, just because it's outside of Austria-Hungary. They've determined to go to war, and the rest of Europe will follow them. And peace will quickly fall apart. Now, this whole story you can go see with newspaper reports and everything in Memorial Hall here, in the On the Brink exhibit. Once Germany invades Belgium, Britain decides to intervene. And the words of Sir Edward Grey, the lamps are going out all over Europe. He knows Britain's going to war. He's looking outside his office, and he sees the people who light the lamps in the evening extinguish them in the morning. And he says, we shall not see them again in our lifetime. And Britain declares war on Germany. And that is when it all started. So thank you very much. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. They do?
Yes.
So the Grafenstift 1912 convertible has a reverse.
Even from the 1900 Oldsmobile.
Reverse, okay. Sir.
I served with the 35th Infantry Division for S-413 in 2003 in Bosnia. And it seems like it's pretty clear that there are a lot of connections between the most current Bosnian Muslim war with Serbia, the Bosnian Serbs, and the 1914 and prior era. Do you have any reflections on that connection?
Yeah. I can maybe reflect a little bit on it. I mean, one of the reasons I think Notre Dame hired me as a Habsburgist is because this world, the world before 1914, at least the world before 1918, becomes much more relevant to the world after 1989 and the fall of communism. And we see over the course of the interwar period, the First World War, it broke up a lot of monarchies, but also created a lot of new tensions. And the aftermath of the First World War created a lot of new tensions. And so keep coming back to this museum over the next 4 years, because you're going to learn a lot of 20th century history through this. But Serbia united Yugoslavia after the First World War. And they didn't ask anyone really if they wanted to belong to it. They just thought they would. And over the course of the 20th century, the Serbs proved to be just as much of an overlord to the various peoples of Bosnia as the Austrians were. So it was new rulers, same methods, basically, or even differing methods. Whether peace will be maintained in Bosnia, recently there was a series of bombings in Sarajevo just this year, is anyone's guess. But part of the problem, I think, in the U.S. is that this history, the history of Eastern Europe, has been so neglected that when things flare up, we always act surprised. And it's because we sort of did a bad job of putting it together in 1918, 1919, 1920.
Wasn't Germany in the midst of mobilization in the middle of July to attack Belgium and France?
No. In fact, Germany was, they only mobilized after Russia began, and they asked Russia several times to stop. But their war plans had them going through Belgium. And so one of the interesting things about the Western Front is, you know, the Schlieffen plan that goes through Belgium, right? The Germans, when they invade France, they want to go through Belgium quickly and try to encircle the French army. Of course, this means Germany's putting all of its forces in the west and asking Austria to hold on the east for a while. And of course, the front bogs down in the west very quickly by the end of September, early October 1914. And by this point, Russia has concentrated 80% of its army against Austria-Hungary. And over the course of the first 5 months of the war in 1914, Austria will lose its entire professional army. 1.1 million men will be gone. So thank you, Schlieffen.
One question is, a lot of people are writing, in terms of the Germans, once it started, they couldn't back away because of their mobilization tables and their plans. I was curious if the Austrian-Hungarians had a similar thing. Once the decision was made, the bureaucracy of the war took over and they couldn't back out even if they wanted to?
You know, I think, the way historians call that, it's called war by timetable, right? The timetables are set, we're going to war, there's no turning back. What this really indicates is that the military leadership wanted war, and that this was their opportunity to have it, and that they didn't have to listen to politicians anymore. So this was the excuse. This was the excuse to keep war going. And in what you see in most countries in Europe is the state of siege, or a declaration of a state of emergency or a state of exception, where military necessity takes over and assumes control of the states and all state politics. And so the military commanders want war at this point, and they're going to say anything they can to keep getting it, to the point where in Russia they promise, the military leadership of Russia says, well, since you don't really want a full-scale war, we'll do this thing called partial mobilization, and we'll only mobilize the districts next to Austria. They lied to the Tsar. They didn't know how to partially mobilize. They didn't have any plans. But Tsar Nicholas signs a document going to war thinking that, oh, we're only partially mobilizing. In Austria, the sort of whole mobilization thing is botched from the very beginning, precisely because Potiorek and Conrad, the two heads of the army, one that got passed over and one that is the supreme commander, are at odds with each other. And Potiorek wants to lead an invasion into Bosnia, or into Serbia right away. And Conrad needs those troops to hold back the Russians. And so what happens in Austria is they mobilize against Serbia really quickly, and they're ready to invade. And then Russia declares war, and they have another oh crap moment, and have to send those troops from Bosnia and the Serbian border back up to Galicia on the Russian border. And the train tables at this point are all so messed up that the Austrian troops end up getting dropped off 30 miles behind the front and having to march quickly and then engage an enemy. So mobilization for Austria is a complete disaster. I can give you a hunch, being an historian of Austria-Hungary and not only a World War I historian. My expertise comes out of the sort of state history of Austria-Hungary. And that is that even in 1914, states have become so complex, military matters have become so complex, that monarchs do not have absolute power anymore. They have to rely on advisors and officials. And if the advisors and officials are feeding them, they're like historians. They select the facts they want to give and put the story together, and the monarch approves it, because they have to rely on good people. And so even though they were three cousins, they were each sitting in Berlin, St. Petersburg, and London. And they weren't talking to each other so much as talking to the people around them.
So if Franz Ferdinand's children were not to ascend to the throne, who did Josef think was going to take control of the empire?
It was the next eldest person in line. So Franz Ferdinand had a younger brother who was a libertine, who famously walked in the Hotel Zacher wearing nothing but a saber. And he was next in line. That's true. He died of syphilis. There are some mercies. He died of syphilis in 1906. And his eldest son was an archduke by the name of Franz Karl, but he took the name Charles, emperor. He became emperor in 1916. When Franz Josef died at the age of 86. And so the last emperor of Austria-Hungary was the nephew of Franz Ferdinand and the great nephew of Franz Josef. We have a question here and one over here.
So, go ahead.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi. Thank you very much for your lecture this afternoon. I'd like to ask you a question about the state history of Austria. Which is, can you discuss how this state even functioned internally? Was it a state where the Germans and Hungarians dominated all of the other ethnic groups? That's kind of what I'm getting at, but I'm not clear about how the state functioned, and I'd like to discuss that.
Well, one of the things that I try to do as a lecturer at Notre Dame is sort of normalize this thing. First of all, it actually functioned, and two, it didn't function, as far as states go, all that badly. Now, traditionally, I'm gonna let you in a taste on what I'm working on these days. We see and we read Austro-Hungarian history is that it's dominated by Germans in the Austrian half and Hungarians in the Hungarian half. And everyone else, we're basically cannon fodder for the army. Right? That's what you read in history books. This was more or less invented by British propaganda officers in the First World War. It was the propaganda they used against Austro-Hungarian troops on the front lines, and then these propaganda people in the foreign ministry left their job after the First World War, and what did? They became historians. They taught at the London School of Economics, and University College London, and at the University of Manchester, training the next generation of historians of Central Europe. In the last 30 years, historians, especially in the United States, have gone back and looked at the Habsburg monarchy and said, well, it develops democracy over the course of 50 years. It develops representative institutions. It develops all these forms of local self-government. There are all of these provisions for cultural infrastructure building. So they build the Czechs an opera that's they perform in Czech. They try to erect universities in Italian-speaking zones. And so there's all this infrastructure building, wealth building, material building, economic promotion for all these different national groups. And so people really didn't want to leave the monarchy in 1914. The monarchy was nationally, they got in arguments in parliament against each other, but no one wanted to leave this monarchy. And even recently in the United States, our sort of own fractious Congress sort of leads me to think about the fractious parliamentary environment of Austria-Hungary. Right? If China invades Tamil, did you guys feel like this was an invades Tamil? Did you guys feel like this was an empire crumbling? Were you surprised? Would you be surprised? Yeah, I'd be shocked. But maybe 20 years down the road, historians would say, well, the Republicans and the Democrats didn't get along. We should have seen this coming. This is what happened with Habsburg history. I had one more thing to say about that, but I've forgotten it. okay. And I'll probably remember tonight when I'm trying to sleep. I'll just wake up and say, Parliament!
I have one comment and then something I'd like you to comment on.
Where are you?
Right here.
Oh, there you are.
The first one is that yourself and several other historians that I've read refer to the assassination weapon as a revolver. It's actually an automatic.
It's a Browning pistol.
Yes, in technical terms, of course, which I know historians always prefer to be absolutely correct,
okay.
A revolver would revolve.
Mm-hmm. And this is a Browning, right?
So yes, it's automatic.
Okay.
The second one is I'd like your comments on this. One author I recently read says the Austrian ultimatum to Serbia appeared to be the worst kept secret in Europe.
Can I guess who that was? Was that Sean McMeekin?
It could be.
No?
He thought it might be.
Okay. It probably was the worst kept secret, because Serbia knew it was coming. I mean, that's why the Prime Minister of Serbia got out of town. Ambassadors are good spies. And there's some indication that when Poincaré visits Russia, they already know that Austria is planning a war. And so they actually talk together anyway. But yeah, it seemed to be the worst kept secret. I think that's probably true. And that's why even though Austria was trying to cover its diplomatic rear, so to speak, it completely backfired. I mean, it was waiting to try to prove to the world that we're not just an aggressive state, we're trying to find peace. That was what they wanted to try to prove, and it completely failed. They probably should have just attacked on the next day and given Europe a fait accompli. Because when Putin does it, everyone's surprised he can get away with it. I see you.
There's some speculation over the years, and I guess we'll never have a finite answer, but that one of the reasons why the Serbian nationalist extremists wanted to kill Franz Ferdinand was precisely because he was at least toying with the idea of trialism, of a second hyphen, of giving the South Slavs an equal voice to the Hungarians and the Austrian Empire, and that the last thing they would have wanted would have been a reconciliation between South Slav moderates and the Austro-Hungarian Empire. What would be your perspective on that?
Well, first of all, that's a great question. Franz Ferdinand had a military chancellery. He was allowed to open his own military office in 1898 as sort of political preparation for becoming the emperor. And he, through his military chancellery, had a lot of reports sent to him about politics. He wasn't just involved in the military. He was involved in Austrian politics. And many of those reports, especially later in his in his life toward 1914 were about monarchical reform. How are you going to rearrange the constitution of this place to make it more modern and a little bit less cumbersome? And one of those was trialism, which would have created an autonomous region of Slovenes, Croatians, and Serbs in the south. And toward even later was a United States of Austria, where every sort of national group would get their own province. And it would be modeled on the United States. But these were things that were always circulating through his office. Because Franz Josef was old, and his prime minister's, Franz Josef the old emperor, his prime minister's goal was to change as little as possible because it might kill the old man. And no one knew what was going to happen when Franz Ferdinand became emperor. And so this also generated even more reform plans. They wanted to get his eye. Hey, do this. This is, you know, our flashy Maytag, you know, washing machine that also promises imperial reform. And so the very nature of his office, the very nature of the fact that there's an old emperor means there's lots of reform plans coming through. I don't know if the Serbs thought that deeply about it. I don't think they did.
Hi, Professor Deak.
Ah, hi, Vanessa.
It's good to be in your classroom again.
Yeah, thanks. Good to see you.
Now, my question is a little bit of alternative history, which is a very questionable exercise sometimes.
Well, I made you read alternative history last year, so.
Indeed. Sometimes the story of World War I is told, like with the ideas of nationalism, rising nationalism, colonialism as a inevitable war. The war was coming, no matter what. The story you told is a story of chance and near misses. And so could you speak to the question of, if it wasn't this, would something else have sparked the Great War? Or do you think that this was it?
Okay, thank you. Vanessa was one of my students last year. Thanks for giving me a stumper. I think, I think the very nature of the way this war started sort of leads you to see how chance in history is so important. Now, the other alternative story that this is a volcano that's ready to erupt, that also provides a lot of compelling evidence that maybe if the assassination of Franz Ferdinand wasn't the spark, there would be another spark. But tellingly for me, Franz Ferdinand was assassinated, and Austria-Hungary became involved in the war. And if it had been another spark, a colonial spark, between France and Germany, say, or between Germany and Britain, I don't know how involved Austria-Hungary would have gotten. And of course, the war eventually would tear Austria-Hungary apart. So this war was, the war that was started this way, was really the worst case scenario for Austria-Hungary. And I know I didn't answer your question, but you kind of gave me an unanswerable one. But thanks.
Professor, first of all, I apologize for mispronouncing your name when you walked in this afternoon. I was wondering if you could speak to the failure of the Austrian command to synchronize their war planning with Germany, especially in July, with Moltke already happening to be on vacation nearby.
Okay. Well, I'm going to give you an easy, maybe unsatisfactory answer, and that is Conrad thought he was running the show, and they didn't have to do this. And it was only after losing the entire army on the Eastern Front by January 1915 that Conrad sort of said, well, I have to actually treat the Germans as an equal partner. And by this point, the Germans were like, hell, we're not an equal partner. We're your boss. Conrad wanted to fight his own war. And he had no interest. This was his war against Serbia and against Russia. And of course, the Germans left him in the lurch anyway. They were attacking on the Western Front. And they said, you know, you Austrians, you hold the line. Well, that's easy to do, but except when you have 1.3 million Russians storming over the border into Galicia. And they were just completely overrun. I've seen great documents signed by Conrad, dated 19 August 1914. And the document says, we anticipate overrunning large areas of Russian Poland in the next week. Please round up all of your Polish-speaking officials who can serve as translators for us. 6 days later, the capital of Galicia fell to the Russians. 2 weeks later, more or less the entire province was under Russian control, except the very end toward Krakow. They had no idea what they were doing. They really didn't. And it was only losing the war that actually allowed Conrad to sort of condescend to talk to the Germans anyway.
Let's take one last question and then we'll wrap it up here. Stacy, could you give this gentleman the mic?
A corollary to the last question, were the Austrians at least aware of the Schlieffen Plan and that they're risking a wider war in Europe if they went to war with Serbia, or were they expecting a kind of localized conflict just between Russia, Germany, and themselves?
Great question. Optimistically, they were looking for just a localized conflict against Serbia. And they thought Germany's public declaration that they were going to back Austria would keep Russia out of the war. And what they really didn't have good intelligence on was that Russia was going to enter whatever war was there. Russia was just from the very outset prepared to enter this war. And so I don't know how much Conrad actually knew about the Schlieffen Plan. I know when it was implemented, he was very upset about it because he saw what was going to happen, or he could imagine what was going to happen. Of course, he sent his troops into the battle anyway, costing about 450,000 dead and almost 600,000 wounded or missing. And so Russia's entry into the war was really crucial. And after 1915, Austria is basically fighting with a completely newly put together, not well-trained army. So the Schlieffen Plan ended up costing him a lot. I don't know how much he knew about it well in advance, but he thought Russia would stay out of the war. And by the time it was apparent that Russia was coming in the war, he sort of had already cast his dice, and it was too late, and he didn't want to change his mind. Well, thank you all for your questions.
Thank you.